more speakers. Margherita Ganeri, Marcella Bencivenni, and Stan Pugliese. Just briefly, and then they'll just follow one another automatically. Margherita, as I mentioned earlier today, is our connection to the University of Calabria, and the person with whom this whole relationship has developed. And Marcella Bencivenni is instead our colleague here at CUNY. She's at Hostos Community College, and she is going to talk to us later about the Sorbir Civi Calabresi, and that's part of the work that she's been doing. And then Stan Pugliese, who is a historian of Italy in his own right, teaches at Hofstra, will also talk to us about his memories of Calabria. And so I would just ask them to each one follow one another. The only thing I have to do is when you come up, I got to put the thing back up. Other than that, Margherita, it's all yours. Prego.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, the title of my talk is Calabria in Italian and Italian-American Literature, and of course it's a very broad and large topic, so I'm just going to talk about just a partial aspect of the problem. I would like to start in saying that Calabria, until 10 to 15 years ago, was almost as absent in Italian, the so-called canon Italian literature. It was almost absent, and when it was present, it was represented as an underdeveloped region, very far from civilization and very far from the centers of cultural and intellectual life. Cristo si è fermato ad Eboli by Carlo Levi, it's a novel that still has, or had until 10 years ago, a certain influence in the public sphere in Italy, and Calabria, of course, is far below Eboli. So even the best regional writers are, and up to today, are not included in the so-called great canon of Italian literature. While Sicilian writers, of course, made the canon of the novel, at least in the 19th and 20th century Italian literature, Calabrian are still considered minor and provincials. Among those, also writers like Corrado Albaro, Saverio Strati, Mario Lacava, and others like Riccardo Misasi, even less known. It's interesting to know that the translation of the title of one of the most important novels by Corrado Alvaro, Gente in Aspromonte, published in 1930, was translated into English with the title Revolt in Aspromonte. This decision of the translator, as it was noted by some critics, showed that the publisher, thinking about the Anglophone audience, was not willing to accept the dark representation of Calabria there it's in the novel by Alvaro. There has never been an organized revolt in southern Italy. The title of the book, thus, translating Gente into revolt, is disingenuous. It makes an active case out of something that was intended by the author to be passive. There was no hope at all in Alvaro's writings, as there was any hope in the real historical reality of Calabria after unification. In Alvaro's novel, there is a harsh condemnation of Italy, depicted as most violent, corrupt, and unjust country ever. Alvaro comprehended the societal pathology endemic to Italy. In the last word of the book, in the last part of the book, there is the protagonist, Antonello, returning to his village from brutal labor elsewhere. He has almost starved himself to death by sacrificing himself for his family and comes back with a strong intent of vengeance. So he tortures the forest and they were owned by the local nobility, who are depicted as stupid and very mean person, and he speaks the last word of the book, waiting to be captured by the forest rages by the police in flames. So I quote here. He says, "At last, I've met justice face to face. It's taken me long enough to catch up with her and say what I have to say." There he awaited his fate when he saw the gleam of the carabinieri's caps and their guns pointing at him from behind the trees. So there is the sentence in the novel and then the last words of the character saying, "I've met justice, finally." This justice, of course, is the mentioned thing. So in the last lines of the novel, there is a powerful image of Calabria, wild and violent, compared to hell in fire. Now, Calabria was the Italian region that in time registered the largest number of emigrants, as everybody knows here. And therefore, there is a large number of Italian-American writers who have Calabrian origins. And generally, the cultural heritage of the region is felt very strongly by the people who left, and of course, by their descendants, as we saw also this morning with the talk of Joseph Luzzi and Mark Rotella. Due to its large number of emigrants in time and space, we can even say that Calabria is probably more abroad today than there, than on the toe of the boot. Nonetheless, due to its economical and cultural depression, Calabria is rarely visited for touristic purposes, and therefore is very little known, not even by descendants of Calabrians. Of course, I'm talking about Calabria today. In Reimagining Southern Italy in 2008, Kenneth Scambray writes, quote, "Before we left California, I told as many people as I could that we were going to the South. Just about everyone has an opinion on Calabria, but few have ever visited the land. That stereotype of the South as an impoverished land of struggling, uneducated peasants, the land of the archetypal Southern cafone, is still predominant, especially among Italian North Americans. But when I questioned them, they could not name the village or even the province from which their grandparents emigrated. I was warned to be careful. We could be robbed or kidnapped. Making matters worse, according to newspapers' reports covering a recent gangland killing, the Calabrian 'Ndrangheta has now supplanted the Sicilian mafia as the most powerful criminal organization in Italy," unquote. At the end of this report, the author Scambray writes, luckily, I have to say, at the end he says, quote, "Calabria defies those negative images that persist in the popular imagination. I had visited several times. I knew that I wouldn't see any members of the 'Ndrangheta roadside holding on the streets, on their shotguns and blah. And I see people with guns more on downtown streets of Los Angeles or on the promenade of Santa Monica," and so, unquote. So this is to talk about the stereotypes that are still alive, but at the same time, there are now some books that try to defy those stereotypes today. Now, one of the most interesting and rich, but also realistic representation of Calabria, as it was before this change that happened in the last 10 years, is offered by the novel Umbertina by Helen Barolini, published in 1979. Compared to other classics of Italian-American literature prior to World War II, such as Son of Italy by Pascal D'Angelo, or Christ in Concrete by Pietro Di Donato, or Wait Until Spring Bandini by John Fante, Umbertina tells a story which has a much less dramatic social scene in the background. The novel witnessed the different and now integrated role in the American context of the Italian generations following the first and the second one. So the novel evokes the past from a different standpoint, which is the standpoint of a present in which the process of the Americanization of Italians in the United States is positively completed. And in my point of view, not coincidentally, the writer over time ended up regarding her own writing as, quote, 100% American and not as Italian American anymore. So when Tina, daughter of Marguerite, so great-granddaughter of Umbertina, of the woman who migrated from Calabria, when she visits Calabria and the small village of Castagna, where her great-grandmother came from, she feels disoriented like an intruder. Quote, More and more she seemed to herself an intruder in a place that was as much a ruin as the monastery below them. And what was the use of pursuing Umbertina, she asked herself. This coming to Castagna had been more to lose as herself than to find Umbertina. She felt the rightness of standing there, and yet she stood there as a stranger. The homeland now as a foreign place as others she kept traveling to, unquote. Now Tina brings back to America a rosemary plant, as did Umbertina almost a century before. Rosemary in Calabria is loaded with connotations, I must say religious connotation, which historically allude both to fidelity, also in marriage, and to immortality. In fact, in Greek and medieval times, it was traditionally used at weddings as much as in funerals. For Umbertina, the plant was a symbol of continuity with the past, and therefore a symbol also of journey, of loss, and of death, which overlap and interpose continually in the evolution of the present. Now I have some quote, but I'm just gonna skip those quotes. The rosemary is just very present in the novel. Just let me read just one. After Tina plants the rosemary in her new house at the end of the trip, she says, quote, she has done her planting and a sense of well-being pervaded her. Her place was marked. All the positions to come between her and Jason will have this as a focus. Unquote. Water is another central symbol of the novel, and also is an ambiguous symbol, very contradictory. It's both bright and dark. It means life and death at the same time, referring not only to life, of the human being, but also the meaning the prenatal origins of the fetus. In the moment of death, of her death, Umbertina thinks of the source of a stream in Castagna, because only the final moment of separation from life manages to bring out in her the removed nostalgia of her land. So in fact, the problem is that the striking figure of Umbertina, who was very strong and at the same time very ignorant, she was a Calabrian, very poor shepherdess, and she was able to build a fortune in the new world, but at the price of severing her ties forever with her origins, so that after the removal, she will never want to go back. The fact that her last wish before dying is about the water from this native village indicates, however, that this cut was not complete. The aquatic symbol hinting at the origins of life brings back the memory removed and never lost of her roots in Calabria and of her childhood, and therefore of her deepest identity. Now, there are other symbols that are, of course, typical of Calabria in the novel. The other one that I'd like to mention just shortly is the coperta matrimoniale, double blanket. It's a loom woven in typical Calabrian style with bright colors and an elaborate design. And it's Umbertina's unique wealth, but she will be forced to sell it in New York in order to move to another destination. So the bedspread, this bedspread is a precious object, together lost and found as a symbol of Calabria, but also as a symbol of the Italian-American new situation, you know, struggle first and then new, very good and positive situation in the new world. Now, Marguerite decides to take the opposite path to that chosen by her grandmother, driven by an unconscious emulation that elevates the ancestors to a sort of tutelar deity, as like a goddess, her grandmother. And yet, like the writer Helen Barolini, rather than in Calabria, she goes to live in Rome and in Florence when she moves to Italy. And those two cities were also, as I said, the cities where Helen Barolini lived. So this is, Marguerite is the writer's double. And the writer's double does not get to Castagna, to Calabria. And she doesn't really plan to make a journey to discover the original region. Why? perhaps because in her there comes into play the interference of her mother, who had removed her Calabrian origins. This could be a choice, you know, the second generation who don't want to feel their roots, you know. But also perhaps because Margherita is looking for herself in the novel and dies before concluding a process of identity formation. So I want to suggest a third hypothesis also. That's because Calabria is not integrated, as like Rome, as like Florence, in this positive idea of Italy. It is something that, you know, Joseph Lutz said this morning, my two Italies. So Calabria is the second Italy, the other Italy, which is the one that's more difficult to bring it to in a positive light. So this is probably why Marguerite goes to Rome and Florence, and she doesn't even plan to go to the south. But luckily, then we have the figure of Tina, who's the great-granddaughter, who tries to put together these two Italies into one. So the pages related to the travel, Tina actually goes to Castagna, you know, the great-granddaughter. The pages related to the travel she does are very important. They are central to focus on the ambivalent image of the region. On the one hand, it's the real Calabria, the actual region. On the other hand, Calabria is still a metaphor of the lost origin of the family, and therefore is almost like a non-place, to quote the Marc Auger formula. So accumulating real elements and fantastic factors, documentary data and poetic tropes, the land of the ancestor Calabria produces a series of family and identity myths, such the animalization that evokes the proverbial passions, stubbornness, and slowness of its inhabitants, testardi, we're gonna see the movie later on, the short by Lucia Grillo. So among the many archetypal images evoked by the region, perhaps in my point of view, the most significant is precisely that of the turtle in Helen Barolini's words, in which she, the author Barolini, identifies herself to the point of making it a recurrent self-definition. The Calabrian turtle becomes an icon of the author and of the Italian-American female identity, tenacious and patient, stoically testadura in pursuing his objectives, but also in maintaining the memory of the lost continent and being able to make it coexist with the difficult conquest of the new one. So all these aspects are intertwined with the revival of some stereotypes about the South and by Calabria, which are still popular well beyond Barolini and well after Barolini today. So in Umbertina, the author resumes many of them without even investigating them. So like there is, for example, the proverbial mistress enclosure of the people from Calabria, the stubbornness again, the violent jealousy, but also some cultural references, like for example, the idea that the Bretti, the population that was in Calabria before the Greeks arrived and together with the Greeks, the Bretti were violent, rude, and hostile to contacts and to mixture with the Greeks. Near Castagna, Tina and her companion Ferruccio have an interesting exchange on this issue, in which Ferruccio is the bearer of an anti-Southern point of view, in which he shows the most common prejudices about, you know, the Southern people, but also the Bretti. His historical knowledge of the Bretti is based on clichés that today are considered outdated, though they were still popular not long ago. For several decades, archaeology has unearthed evidence of the peaceful and harmonious existence of the Enotri and then of their direct descendants who took the name of Bretti with the great Greek population, by which they were assimilated, completely assimilated, in a few centuries to the point of adopting their religion. In Cosenza, the former capital of the Bretti Empire, today there is a museum that's called Museo dei Bretti e degli Enotri, which gathers the main recent archaeological discoveries attesting the refined culture and civilization of a people long ignored by official history. due to the influence and often racist judgments of Roman historians and of writers. In Umbertina, Ferruccio is the bearer of that traditional, let's say, point of view, but Tina, and this is very interesting in my point of view, Tina does not believe the words of Ferruccio and feels, in fact, proud, intimately proud over the sense from the indigenous people of antiquity, quote. She was glad that Umbertina and Serafino, those unknown Calabrian progenitors of Earth, were from the ancient Bruti, unquote. So despite the epic mythical tones that accompany the representation of the ancestors, the first part of the novel Umbertina, that's dedicated to the late 19th century Calabria, offers a remarkable realistic reconstruction of Calabria history through a wealth of historical and anthropological documentation, proving to be a reading that has much to teach about the history of Italian migration from Calabria, from the south in general, during the 19th century. Nevertheless, the homeland is configured in the novel more like a foundation myth than as a real territory. If the imagery tied to all Italy in this novel constantly oscillates between history and myth, Calabria seems to lean especially toward the second one, toward the latter. In particular, there seems to be another Italy, a Uber Italy in Calabria, which is a remote ancestral place, but also is an underdeveloped place. But there are signs, especially in the words of Umbertina, that goes opposite, try to see this division about the two Italies in some sort of problematic ways. So at least, so there is a very complex view on Calabria and all this position of Calabria on the other Italy, the Uber Italy. So now to conclude on Umbertina, but I just want to mention that my book on Helen Barolini just came out in English, so I have only one copy here. It's going to be available at the end of May on Amazon. And I want to conclude that, and going back to the new Calabria, we also have the round table there, the new Calabria. So I think it's probably, just to make it more clear what I'm saying, that Umbertina is one of the best description of Calabria because it records the stereotype, but at the same time, the text itself tries to fight with that. So there is a complex double view on Calabria, which is at the same time realistic, and on the other side also in movement, also trying to make you see different aspects. But now, as I said at the beginning, in the last 10 to 15 years, Calabria really is changing. It's a new there is a new Calabria coming up. First of all, as I said before, that in the Italian so-called canon, until 10 to 15 years, Calabria was almost absent, and now it's different. Now we are facing a new trend. There are lots of writers, lots of novels that talk about Calabria, and Calabria is becoming an important topic in contemporary literature, especially in among a new generation of the so-called engaged writers. And talk about 'Ndrangheta, of course, and talk about new immigrant writers, just to mention some names. For example, Mimmo Gangemi, who's the author of Anime Nere, the film by Munz, you probably know, Giuseppe Aloe, Emanuele Bianco, Vince Gallico, Angela Bubba, Giovanni Tiziano, who's also, as Roberto Saviano, was threatened by 'Ndrangheta. But also I will include in this list Amara Lacus, that Anthony just mentioned at the beginning, because the novel by Amara Lacus, Contesa per un maialino italianissimo a San Salvaro, really talks about the Calabria. The protagonist is a Calabrian character who moves from Calabria to Turin to work at Fiat. So I think it's very much into the Calabria new debate, let's call it. There is also a new interest for Calabria in contemporary cinema. Munzi, I've already mentioned it, but also I can mention Il Sud e Niente by Fabio Mollo, came in 2013, and Le Quattro Volte by Fra Martino, 2014. So of course there is a new interest also on 'Ndrangheta, okay, which is not only simply Italian interest in Italy. There is a new debate on 'Ndrangheta, and there are some international bestsellers on that. I would like to mention The Cobra by Frederick Forsyth, published in 2011, British. I can mention Debt in Calabria too, another international, even though it's not really in Calabria, but it has got Calabria in the title. And there are other books that if you're interested, you can ask me later. So there is a new interest on Calabria in this. And of course, there is this interest in 'Ndrangheta. I just want to say very fast. I mean, of course, that is that Calabria became the criminal organization, the first, not only Italian, criminal organization. It's very powerful. It's much more powerful than the Sicilian mafia and the Camorra. So that explains a new interest in that. But on the other side, there is a new debate on the questione meridionale, on the southern questione. That's also a recent debate. Of course, I'm talking now anymore not about fiction. It's essays and academic books. And one of the most important books is Pensiero Meridiano, came out in 2007 by Franco Cassano. And there is it produced a very lively and interesting debate on what's the South and what's the situation of the philosophers in the South and so on. And in this trend, which is a very lively, as I said, but also not everything is very good in quality, there is also the case by Pino Aprile, Terroni, that Anthony mentioned at the beginning, and there is also a new so-called movement called the Neo-Bourbons, people who wants to show that the history before unification of Calabria, but of the South in general, the part of history before unification was much better than the unified Italy. But the problem is, this is of course a very interesting debate, and I think it's got strong connection with what was happening in the literary field, in novels. But at the same time, I should really say that some of these books are really commercials, and some of them don't have any historical seriousness. We were talking before the footnotes, you know, the scientific books. Like, for example, in my point of view, Pino Aprile was very successful. At the same time, sometimes it doesn't have an historical rigorous perspective on lots of things that he mentions. And there is this book that was on sale here. Is a reply to also, you can see that Alessandro Tarzia, Perché l'Ndrangheta, is a reply against Pino Aprile and others. So this new situation, to conclude, it's creating a new context for intellectual exchanges and intellectual reflections also on the past. But what I want to say is that that's probably happening, not because the situation economical and cultural in Calabria is improved. On the opposite, I would like to say that this is happening because the situation is probably worse than in the past. Calabria today is not only the place where the first criminal organization spread was very rich, is still the poorest region in Italy, even though 'Ndrangheta is very rich, but as you know, its business are outside the region. They're much more outside than inside. And 'Ndrangheta has built an impressive empire, economical empire, but this business are carried on in Northern Italy, in Europe, in the United States, in Canada, in Australia, not in Calabria. So this is why Calabria does not benefit at all about this richness. Calabria is also today one of the areas of Italy where the immigrants mostly arrive from the sea. Not everybody knows that the bigger the biggest centro di accoglienza for migrants is in Crotone. I'm saying the biggest in Europe, not the biggest in Italy. So underdevelopment, unemployment, economical crisis, political corruption, and the enormous power of drunkenness are still in Calabria today, and in my point of view, they are worse than they used to be in the past. But this, paradoxically, this create the condition to have in Calabria an ideal situation to observe what's happening outside in all Italy and potentially in all the, you know, the Mac world, all the globalized economy. As in psychoanalytic therapy, what happens in the margin is often more meaningful than what happens in the center. In this, in its degraded scenario, Calabria could qualify itself as being a privileged observatory of the what's really happening, of the consequence of the economies in the Mac world, as it was, it used to be in the past, it's still today, it's one of the best places in Italy from where to dominate the scenes of recent migration in the shade of the previous historical ones. So what I'm saying, this is why I don't agree with Pino Aprile and others, want to do a new pride of being from the South. Oh yeah, yes, we can be proud, but not at the cost of saying that the situation in Italy was better, was very good in the past, or can be good today in some areas. No, situation is very bad, but this is a key, the key, this gives us the key to really observe what's happening elsewhere. You know, after years of globalization, like postmodernism, and, you know, all the, Peter Caravetta is an expert on that, the dialectic relation between center and periphery was completely ruined. Now we don't have any more centers and peripheries. We have like a web, you know, the spread. Who lives in periphery today? With the internet, with the web, no one is really, you know, Calabria is not anymore an archaic land as it used to be in Alvaro and all the others, even in Umbertina, because there are not archaic lands anymore in the globalized world. Who lives in Calabria today is connected with the rest of the world, okay? It's what I'm saying. And also, Calabria is becoming a multicultural society, even more than other regions in Italy, because of this history of migration and because of people coming all the time. So it's multicultural, but not in a good way, I mean, in a problematic way. So the only way to consider the importance some periphery, used to call them periphery, like Calabria, can have it today, is by considering a privilege to be in a place where the social, economical contradiction happens in a way more, you know, they are more devastating in that area than in other parts. So if you consider that the social contradiction are stronger there, like in the psychoanalytic pattern I was mentioning before, in the margin, something, you know, that there is unnoted but is stronger happen. If you look what's happening in Calabria, you have a picture of what could happen in the rest of the globalized society. There is a risk, you know, we are going probably to a calabricizzazione of Italy, and calabricizzazione maybe of the globalized world. And I hand it up here. Okay.
Marcella Bencivenni, I do know most of you.
Hold on.
Yeah.
Hello?
Good.
Okay. So I just wanted, first of all, to really commend Anthony Tamburi for putting this together. It's a wonderful opportunity for people to really reflect, as Margherita was pointing out, to the changes that have been taking place on both perceptions, self-perceptions of Calabria. And so I want to just start by saying that when Anthony actually asked me to participate and, you know, talk about a topic, I was really kind of, what am I going to do? You know, I was born and raised in Calabria. I came here when I was 25. So for me, actually studying Italian-American history has never been about, you know, trying to reconcile my ethnic identity. I never went through that kind of tension. I really began to study Italian American history for historical reasons. So I could have talked though about so many things related to Calabrian culture, identity, values, things that are still very dear to me. I could have talked about, you know, family stories. I come from a very large family on both sides of my mom and my father. I could have talked, of course, about food. I love that. But then I really thought about, well, you know, I really need to talk actually about my work and to bring a Calabria into it. So what I decided to do was really using some of my research, highlight some of the stories that, you know, speak of, you know, people from Calabria that, again, stories that are little known, stories that have been neglected, but they are being somehow rediscovered. These are actually the covers of the two books that I, one I have an article on it, and it was actually published in Italy by Rubettino, so it's an edited collection. As you can see, the title is Calabresi Sorvessivi nel Mondo, which is part of, again, this kind of a new attempt to rediscover the different regional contributions to the Italian diaspora. In this particular case, again, it's radicalism, but I know that there have been many other volumes that have been focusing on specific contributions from specific regions of Italy. And the other one is actually my recent book, not so recent anymore, 2011, called Italian Immigrant Radical Culture. And so Calabria is a part of this story, and you know, of course I knew that, but you know, by doing this talk, it kind of forced me to actually acknowledge that in a more deeply and more meaningful way. So when I started to my research, one of the things that I was trying to do in you know, talking about this immigrant radical world was to tell the stories of the people that contributed to that world. So I've been researching for about 10 years at this point about both the political and the cultural world that made, you know, Italian immigrant labor and radicalism. And one very important source is for historians, that is actually an archive that exists in Italy at the Archivio Centrale di Stato. Now, when I started my research, this was not available online. I had to actually go on the archive and look at the catalog one by one. But today, what's beautiful about this is that they have actually digitized the collection, and so you can have access to a lot of like quantitative data that can give you a very quick glimpse about, you know, okay, what are the numbers? What are we talking about? So let me first say that, and it's hard probably for you to see this, that this is an archive that was actually put by together by Italian authorities, by the state, the police. And it essentially includes about 160,000 files of people who were identified as sovversivi. And this is actually the term that, you know, Italian authorities used back then. It started in the late 19th century, and then it went on until literally 1945. So this practice of literally spying and monitoring people that were perceived as radicals continued until the fall of fascism. Now, what's phenomenal about this is that this is not just including people who were active in Italy. This is following people that moved to other parts of the world, and through the use of embassies, they basically continued to exchange information between Italy and whichever, you know. So if you look here, right, so there is a way to actually narrow this down to the countries that you want to look at. And so if you look at Calabria, let me see if I already passed it. You can get to the number and then eventually the names, right, of all the people. So from these, we know now, bear in mind that these are the people that were actually identified. This does not include the supporters, people who were sympathetic in the movement. So of course the numbers for the people who participated in these radical movements are much bigger. But we know that, you know, so there are about, you know, over 1,000, right? People from Calabrian descent who went, you know, who were perceived as subversivi. And then if you look here in the place of basically where they went, right? So the United States of America, we know that there were at least 305, right, of these people that were identified as leaders, as organizers, and you actually can get now the full names. And again, although this is a real just partial mirror, and another thing I should mention is that there are so many mistakes in these archives. And I mean, I think part of it was that it was done by people that were not necessarily trained, you know, to do this right. So there are misspellings of names. So there are people who were actually anarchists who are identified as communists, you know, and that kind of mistakes. But overall, it's a wonderful, you know, way to get a profile, you know, of who these people are. And so I want to bring your attention to a couple of things that help us, again, kind of defy some of the stereotypes that Margarita was pointing out. First of all, if you look at the jobs, right, that these subversivi, these people that were identified as subversivi held, you can see that there is a wide variety of them. The artisan category, which includes people like shoemakers, tailors, you know, carpenters, masons, barbers, are actually the majority if you put all of them together. But we also see that, and again, it's hard for you guys to see that, the 44 were identified as contadini, as peasants, which again kind of challenges the idea that peasants were apolitical or that peasants were had no you know, pre experience of, you know, labor. And I mean, even within the American labor historiography, the idea has been for a long time that, you know, Americans, Italian Americans, became active in the labor movement as a result of Americanization, essentially, right? Not because they, you know, they had the political consciousness. It also, there is another interesting trend here, which shows that from a political point of view, the overwhelming majority were anarchists or identified as anarchists, followed by socialists. But then, of course, with the rise of fascism, we have also a lot, you know, a number, an increasing number of anti-fascists and communists that were brought in. So this is just, again, just a little introduction, right? But I just recently discovered that this is online, and I think it's a wonderful opportunity for those of you who are interested in this to get some of the, you know, the basic information out. So what I wanted to do was just give you a few stories that relate to people of Calabrese descent. And, you know, these are people who really contributed in a variety of ways to the radical movement, in some ways mostly by being a labor organizer. This is Emilio Grandinetti, who was born in the province of Catanzaro, came to the United States, if I'm not mistaken, in 1907, and really became one of the most important organizers in the garment unions. He was located in Chicago and other parts of the Midwest, but it was, you know, truly recognized as a pioneer in organizing, you know, garment workers. And he was one of the main leaders of the strike in Chicago in 1910, which actually was before the big wave of strikes that started with the Lorenzo strike and then culminated in 1919. Now, what's interesting about Emilio Grandinetti is that And this goes back again to this theme of rediscovery of this recent from Italy. You know, I was stunned, you know, that actually at the Collatura, which is the native place of Grandinetti, they actually organized just a year ago a whole event commemorating, you know, Emilio Grandinetti with, you know, some political figures intervening, Katia Massaro, who actually contributed to the book that I mentioned before and is a professor at the University of Calabria. So, you know, so it's interesting, like, to me, it's like interesting how much it's actually happening that we are not aware. And when I say we, I mean, like, even people in the field, right? I wasn't aware that there was, and there is actually now a whole, a study on Grandinetti online put together by a high school professor, Giuseppe Mussolino, from, you know, from this area. He wrote a wonderful, actually, book on Michele Pane, but he's also doing work on Emilio Grandinetti. I don't know why this keeps disappearing. Okay, let's just give it a second. Did I touch anything? It's just, they went blank. It's just a blank, I don't know, it's, but let me just keep going, it's okay. So another really fascinating figure, and the reason why she is so fascinating in some ways is because she is a woman, and we know that, you know, women have been perceived again in very stereotypical way as very traditional, as apolitical, as confined at home. And so I find it very interesting that, in fact, the most important Italian-American woman in the labor movement is of Calabrese descent. Her name is Angela Bambace, and she was actually born in Buenos Aires, but her parents were from Calabria. And also, you know, her story is a typical, again, transnational story of, like, different movements, right? So she, you know, her parents meet in Buenos Aires, but they're both from, I think one is from Calabria, the other one is from Naples. And she's born there, they go back to Calabria for a little bit, then they come to New York, and she starts working as a garment worker. And she's very much radicalized by the conditions that she finds here, and she becomes very active in the ladies' garment unions, international ladies' garment unions. And not only does she become very active, but in fact she becomes the most important, you know, female leader of the union. And in 1956, she was nominated vice president, the first woman, not Italian American woman, but the first woman in the United States to reach that position. You know, it would be too long, obviously, to bring up all the names, but there is also a very strong tradition of radical poets. And again, the Calabresi are very well represented in that tradition. There are at least three poets that stands out. Francesco Greco and Pietro Greco, who are not related, but they were both from the province of Catanzaro. And in the case of Francesco Greco is actually, together with Michele Pane, recognized as one of the best poets of that generation in Calabrese dialect. And some of their poems have appeared in volumes. Francesco's volume is called L'anima allo specchio. It was published in 1964. And again, the beauty of the internet is now some of these volumes are being digitized, and so you can actually access them online. One of my favorite one, and I actually do talk about him in my book, is Francesco Pitea. And, you know, he was by no standard a typical intellectual. poet. He was pretty much a working class worker all his life. He worked in the silk industry in New Jersey. He became a really, really strong opponent to Mussolini and a fervent anti-fascist. And he founded a really interesting newspaper called La Scopa, The Broom, in Paterson, New Jersey, which went on for about 5 years until he was suppressed. And in that newspaper, he published most of his poems. And his poems are really funny. They are basically, they use a satire, the way in which Peter was talking about, as a tool to denounce Mussolini and to make fun of him. And he put all these poems under this rubric they called the Serenata, right, where he was trying to make fun, essentially, of Mussolini. And there is one short verse in dialect. I'm not going to be as good as Peter in reading this, but I'm going to try. And this is, again, meant to be really funny. But this is a short verse that he published. Ci sono, a quanto sembrami, certi fascisti fini, chi portino la cimicia e su mensi spazzini. So, you know, he was really making fun, which was a very, actually, widespread practice among the subversivi, you know, who made fun of this, you know, pseudo-fascist, you know, where, to their view, quite ignorant, and yet, you know, had all this power in their hands. Another fascinating figure, of course, is Alessandro Sisca, who was probably the best known playwright in the Little Italies. And even though most people think of him as a Neapolitan because he studied in Naples and he wrote a lot of his plays and romanze, you know, he wrote songs and melodramas in Neapolitan. But in fact, he was from Calabria. He was born near Cosenza, and he spent his childhood there, and then he went to Calabria to Naples to study for college, and then he came to the United States, and along with his father and brother, founded another important newspaper, La Follia, and that became again the vehicle for most of his poetry and plays. And there are at least four works that I identified in which he specifically evokes Calabria. One is a one-act drama called Quando in Calabria c'erano i briganti. I think the title is very, you know, doesn't need an explanation. He also gave many lectures, and one of the lectures they gave was on Calabrian history. It was called La Calabria e la sua storia. It also translated a really interesting poem written by his father entitled Luciuccio, and he translated that both in Italian from the Calabrese dialect and in English. And finally, he wrote a poem entitled Ode alla Calabria, which was included actually in his collection of published poems called Poesie Scelte. These are some of the people, again, that I thought, you know, were more representative to me. And I want to just end with one additional story, not of a poet, but of a writer, nevertheless. You might have heard of him, Michele Salerno. His son, Eric Salerno, actually wrote a sort of memoir of his father's experience. It's called Rossi a Manhattan. If we had the thing, you would be able to see the book. The book actually came out originally in the 2000, but it was reissued an edition very recently. And is receiving a lot of attention. So Michele Salerno was one of the many who came here, you know, after fascism, right? So he came here to escape fascism. He became very involved in both the anti-fascist movement and the emerging communist movement. But what makes his history very interesting, besides the fact that he became the editor of the main communist Italian-American newspaper, L'Unità Operaia, was that he was one of the first victims of the Cold War, right? In 1950, it was arrested, and he was deported along with his family back to Italy. And so his son writes the story, of which he knew very little, because when he was repatriated, it was like, you know, a young boy. But he got curious about the story of his father and why he was sent back to Italy, and he requested the files on his father from the FBI. And so once he gets the package, right, he rediscovers this history, of which, again, he did not know about. And that's part of what I've been doing, you know, in my research, trying to recover these lost histories and, you know, why they are important. And I would like to just conclude with a quote, actually, from Alessandro Portelli, who is a very well-known scholar in Italy, particularly with respect to the theme of memory and oral history. And in reviewing the book of Rossi in Manhattan, he talks about, again, this theme of lost history and what it means. And he refers particularly to an interesting thing that in Castiglione Cosentino, which is the place where Michael Salerno was from, they actually had the section of the Communist Party named after him, right? Now, that section doesn't exist anymore, right? There is no communist, you know, branch. However, the name, you know, the sign is still there. And so this is what he writes. He say, l'insegna scomparsa della sezione comunista Michele Salerno di Castiglione Cosentino è la metafora di un vuoto, sangue, intelligenza, passioni negate e cancellate, senza che niente prendesse il loro posto, ma da qualche parte ancora orgogliosamente presenti in forme segreti e imprevedibili. And I think that's what we have been hearing actually the whole day. These stories that seem to disappear, but then somehow they came back for one reason or the other. And I think, you know, that's what we are here for, right? To rediscover more and to, you know, reflect on the significance of these apparently unconnected stories. Thank you.
My presentation is a little different in that it's not so scholarly, but while I was doing it, I was thinking of a comment that Fred Godofay made, Fred, well, at a lunch during a conference one time. He was like, saying about the problem of writing memoir is like, who are you waiting for to die before you can tell certain stories? So, and I was thinking about this because everybody that I'm talking about here, fortunately, is still alive, but they're not here in the room, so I think we can get away with it. So let me begin. I have a series of about 24 photographs that hopefully I can show you, many of them taken by people very close to me, my wife and my daughter, but we'll see if that comes up. Like the nature of memories themselves, this presentation consists of fragments, oftentimes disjointed, of people, events, and places that shaped my childhood, sometimes retroactively. It might even be called a form of what the British Marxist historian Eric Hobsbawm has called the invention of tradition. A complex interaction of the past and the present, ritual and symbols, keeping in mind the fundamental truth in the Italian word ricordare, ridare al cuore, to give back to the heart. And here I have to make three confessions at the beginning. First of all, I am the product of a mixed marriage. My mother's from Calabria, but my father is from the north, Montefalcone, Provincia di Avellino. That joke is from Cinema Paradiso, if you remember, right? And in fact, you know, they met here in America. When my mother had to describe my future father to her parents, she didn't tell them that he was from near Naples. She said that he was from Rome, because he had been living in Rome for 10 years playing for the Bersaglieri. But then when he finally was introduced to my maternal grandparents, his accent gave him away. So this is the product of, you know, a so-called mixed marriage. The second confession, my memories of Calabria are filtered through the memories of my mother and my wife, both of whom were born there. I was not. And in keeping with this theme of invention, artifice, and a personal crafting of the past, I'd like to invoke in my defense the famous Italian saying, se non è vero, è ben trovato, which might be translated, for those of you that don't know, like, if it's not literally true, it's a tale well told, illuminating a larger truth. So let me begin with a parable that I tell my students when I teach Italian American history, or even Western Civ. And I ask them, I'm going to tell you a story, and you tell me the century that I'm describing, right? So we have a poor peasant landless couple struggling to survive in southern Italy. Having no land of their own, they must beg the local padrone, aristocratic family, for permission to work the land. An agreement is reached. The desperate newlyweds can work the land to graze the sheep, but at a cost. A certain amount of milk and cheese must be turned over to the aristocratic family every week. They can work the land and plant wheat, but a certain amount of wheat and bread has to be turned over to the aristocratic family at the end of every month. They can harvest the grapes and make the wine, but 2 barrels of wine have to be turned over to the aristocratic family at the end of the harvest. And they can gather the olives in the Luvara, the olive grove, and they have to give a certain amount of liters of olive oil to the aristocratic family in November. And if there's nothing left over, there's nothing left over. This couple then proceed to have 5 daughters, which is an economic catastrophe. Why? And I hope I'm not offending anybody, but why? Because in this part of the world, in this century, a daughter to be married off needs a dowry, a flock of sheep, la coperta matrimoniale, a little house, an olive grove, something. Or if you don't have that, you're like these 2 poor peasants, you end up getting married to some other morte di fame, and the entire process of miseria and malaria and desperate poverty continues. So then I ask my students, well, what century am I talking about? And they say, oh, professor, you're talking about the Dark Ages. I said, don't use that term, because the Dark Ages had Dante and Gothic cathedrals and scholasticism. Okay, you're talking about the Middle Ages. No, I'm not talking about the Middle Ages. Oh, professor, you're talking about the 1600s. I said, no. I say, I'm talking about Calabria in 1954, and one of those 5 daughters was my mother. So, what do I say to them? I say, not only was one of those 5 daughters my mother, but just a few hours north in Rome, on the Via Veneto, you had the La Dolce Vita and that whole made in Italy, the economic boom and all of that. While just, you know, a few hours away in Calabria, you had conditions that essentially had not changed much from feudalism. So my mother was born in February 1942 in Filandari, provincia di Vibo. It's between Vibo and Tropea. But she never saw Tropea.
Is it Calabria, the PowerPoint?
Yes, that's it.
Okay.
She spent the first year of her life living in a cave, La Grotta di Santa Caterina, because unfortunately the town was situated next to a military airport being bombed in 1942. She lived the first year of her life in a cave. In 1955, at the age of 13, my mother emigrated with her mother and 2 older sisters, leaving behind my paternal grandfather, because he had been denied a visa after having been labeled sovversivo, having inscribed his name into the list of a local peasant agrarian, maybe socialist league. We might look up his name at some point. And so he was not allowed to join them until several years later. My mother and her family eventually made their way to Inwood, New York, not Inwood at the tip of Manhattan, Inwood, which is in the southwest corner of Nassau County, right next to JFK Airport, where that entire town picked themselves up and transplanted themselves in the United States after the Second World War. It was Bob Viscusi who wrote in his memoir, Astoria, devoted to his mother, quote, a whole nation walked out of the Middle Ages, slept in the ocean, and awakened in New York in the 20th century. It's an extraordinary image. I oftentimes think about this, you know, this kind of cultural trauma of going from rural Calabria in 1954 to Long Island. In America, my mother cleaned houses for $5 a day, and she cleaned the local church for free. Today, my family pays women from other countries to clean our house. For this reason, among many others, we return every year to Calabria, not just for vacation, but in an attempt to impress on our children the most unimaginable change over the course of just two generations.
Okay.
Right? Yes? Let's see if I can show you some of these images while telling you the story.
Do it here.
Okay, so let's go. The first, this is the Villa Franzoni of the family that my mother's family had to work the land. The third image, if we go to the third image, is the balcony, the one back, is the balcony of my mother's house in Calabria. So, yes, and the fourth image, okay, we can stop there for a moment. This is an image of the patron saint of Filandari, my mother's town, my wife's town, Santa Marina, a very interesting story of a Turkish woman who was eventually martyred, buried in Turkey, stolen by the authorities in Venice to take her body to Venice, where she reposes today. But at a certain point in the trip, making the way up to the peninsula, stopped outside the town, and the story is that a tremendous storm prevented the pilgrims from bringing the body of Santa Marina, and so she had to stay one night in the town and became the patroness of this town. We can go to the next one. This is another one, and then the next one. This is the same religious procession in the town of Inwood on Long Island. I would argue, let me say this about the trauma that I mentioned with Bob Viscusi. This trauma was borne much better by my mother, who came here as a teenager from Calabria, than my father, who came here as an adult when he was already 30 years old. It seemed that my mother, who was able to learn English and go out into the larger world, she eventually made a life in like retail sales and things like that, was able to become partially American. My father, who returned to his hometown outside of Avellino in 1982 after 20 years, realized a kind of tragic way that he could never go back to his hometown, and yet he was never really fully American, a kind of tragedy that I'm sure was replicated many, many times over. Many of you know Mino Raetano's song Calabria Mia. If we move ahead, we can see, by the way, that good-looking gentleman playing the silver trumpet is me. I play in the Italian street band, and this is the annual procession. It's sort of my purgatory. I try to cleanse all of my sins by playing that religious feast. Those of you that know Calabria Mia, which I always grew up thinking that it was sort of like the quintessential story of Calabrian immigrants, and I think about that song every time I go back to La Mezia, the airport in Calabria. This is a statue that greets us. You can't see it, but the title is L'Antica Soluzione, the ancient solution, which is to get the hell out of there, right? If you don't know the song, I have the original Italian lyrics and my English translations that I can give you. But for those of you that don't know, it's just very briefly, it's like, you know, praying day and night to the Signore that the children return. They know that you're heartbroken, you can't live like this. All the best children of Calabria have left to find their fortune with their feet chained to this land. You remained in these four walls, Calabria Mia, where even the rivers have dried up and our tears end up in the sea. We are sick with love, like these mandolins and guitars. This heart cries out with nostalgia. I cry for you, Calabria. The heart cries out with nostalgia. She prays that her children return, and, you know, and on and on. And it's really heart-rending, you know, whenever you hear this, those of you that know it. So I always thought that this was the experience of Calabrian immigrants. And then I began to realize when I became more of a historian and thinking about this in kind of scholarly way, that it was actually quite different. Growing up, I realized I never witnessed my mother, or my father for that matter, succumbing to nostalgia. There were no wistful, mistful eyes, teary-eyed nostalgia. Only painful, painful memories. My mother was pulled out of school after the third grade to watch sheep in the fields. And to this day, she still has nightmares of the olive harvest. At that time, it was done by hitting the branches with a stick so the olives would fall in the nets on the ground. She still has nightmares of snakes falling on her head as a little child. Now, even, you know, 60, 70 years later. But even with a third grade education, she would often say to me as a child, "Why don't you go play with that nice Steven Bergstein? Why not study with that nice Alan Tannenbaum?" What was going on? With a furbizia that she had gained from centuries of poverty, she had immediately discerned that in America, education mattered. And while my Italian friends and I were setting off fires and fireworks in the schoolyard, she saw my Jewish schoolmates studying hard. My maternal grandfather, my maternal grandmother had similar hopes. In Calabria, as in much of rural Italy, nothing could confer status as much as having a priest in the family. And for landless peasants, this would have been a major step up on the social ladder. So I dutifully became an altar boy, and I found refuge in the silence of the church before Mass, lighting the candles, preparing the wine, and my favorite, preparing the incense for funerals. I even contemplated a career in the priesthood until, around the age of 13, I finally understood what the word celibate meant, and I said absolutely no. But I pleased and honored my mother and her mother by becoming something even better, a college professor. Now, they could have the prestige, and I would have children, and they would have grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And by the way, you might find this interesting. Whether their grandchild or child was a professor at Hofstra or Harvard made absolutely no difference to them. Now, I am the first one to be fully aware that this history could never have happened if my parents had met and remained in Italy. And here is where the story becomes a little more complicated. On the first day of junior high school, which was September of 1977 for me, a young girl sat in front of me in her tight Jordache jeans in Italian class. As you can imagine, concentration on Italian verbs and tenses was very difficult. After 10 years of courtship, she finally decided to date me, and today we have been happily married for 23 years. She was also from Filandari, having been born there, emigrated to the United States, Inwood, 1969. But in Filandari, she had belonged to a family that owned land, and that made all the difference in the world. Her paternal grandfather was one of those birds of passage making their way to America for work, occasionally returning to the Paese to buy land and impregnate their long-suffering wives, the so-called white widows. Giuseppe Romanello had the good sense or the good fortune to leave America 1 week before the Great Depression of 1929. In Filandari, the first thing that he did, besides give his wife another child, was to buy land, as much land as possible. The second thing that he did was he built a cappella, a chapel, in the town cemetery. What did this mean? The result of this was that my wife's family never knew la miseria. They never were hungry. They had seamstresses who made their dresses. The second, and then, of course, there was the question of the cappella in the cemetery, you know. If we go next one, this is the tomb of my maternal great-grandparents. Relatively modest. Some of my relatives don't even have this. As you probably know, in Italy, after a certain number of years, sometimes you are disinterred and your remains are put in an ossuario, like a marble, right? And then into the wall of the town comune. These are people who had actually something a little nicer. So the cappella of my wife's family is a very interesting stucco chapel that I paint and stucco and maintain on our annual summer vacations. By the way, while my mother's deceased relatives are a few blocks away in the cemetery. I said to my wife, I think I've discovered my post-academic career, which is to go around Italian cemeteries restoring chapels, because many of them are in terrible states of disrepair. And if I could just get the children and the grandchildren to feel a little guilty, it's really a very rewarding, I have to say, a very rewarding mestiere, let's say. So the Campo Santo replicates the social hierarchy of the town's history. That aristocratic family that I showed you at the beginning, that my grandparents worked the land, they have the most magnificent cappella. And you know, the peasants are represented in a very different way. Our annual vacations in Calabria are a strange mix of hedonism. I don't want you to think that it's all miseria and cemeteries. So if we go, you'll see we spend our time at the beach at Tropea. And the next one, I don't know if I should show this to you. This is our secret beach at Zambrone. I just sent it to all my relatives, that in Italy, Capo Vaticano and Le Grotticelli has just been announced as the best beach in all of Italy, which means that next year, this year, it's going to be impossible to get over there. So there is this kind of strange mixture on our vacations of hedonism and death, you know. And we see this in the next slide. When driving around Calabria, you see these very melancholy ruins. You know, you think about the meditation on ruins. This is an aqueduct near the town of Spilinga, known for their famous nduja, this kind of delicacy that they make. Or the next one, these roadside chapels that had been created by someone to fulfill, you know, per gracia ricevuta, you know, that are now abandoned. Extraordinary, extraordinary things, and including, this is the Pagliaro in dialect. It was because my father-in-law's family owned land in the country, which was separate from the town. You know, land-owning patterns in southern Italy, they're different, let's say, from America, where farmers actually live on the land. In Italy, southern Italy, you live in the town, and then you go walk to the land. And so instead of walking back and forth in the summertime, my father-in-law created this house, which was on their land and where they would spend their summers. But having been abandoned since 1969, this is the result. And we can even say, this is another, to expand the story from the realm of the personal, not far from our land there is an internment camp from the Second World War of Ferramonte di Tarsia. The first time I went to visit this, I was struck by two things. One, when they built the autostrada from Salerno to Reggio, they built the autostrada smack in the middle of this internment camp, as though, and they just bulldozed, you know, barracks and buildings and structures that had been in the internment camp. And this was sort of like kind of indicative of this. The actual road sign to indicate the directions to the internment camp was like lying on the side of some building, you know, and you had to ask around to try to find it. So all around us are these images of, you know, ruins and decay, and yet, at the same time, as we can see, this was a picture taken only a couple of years ago when I was invited to the University of Calabria to talk about the resistance and Italian Jews. The government has put the resources and the money into, I don't want to say restoring the internment camp, but about 2,000 people, both Italian and foreign Jews, were interned here during the Second World War. And one or two others, you'll see now there is a very interesting museum, as well as the, of course, the La Giornata della Liberazione, the national holiday of the end of the Second World War. I have this academic interest in Italian Judaism, and in the course of this, I came across someone very interesting. This is Rabbi Barbara Aiello, who is the daughter of an American GI who liberated the Dachau concentration camp in April of 1945. She was from an Italian Jewish family in Pittsburgh. She was ordained a liberal rabbi, a reform rabbi in New York City. And in tracing her family history, discovered that her family had come from a small mountain town in Calabria called Sera Stretta, which southern Italian Jews had fled to in the 15th century in the face of persecution. When Ferdinand and Isabel kicked out the last Jews and Muslims from Spain, they also kicked out the Jews from southern Italy, in places like Palermo and Naples, and even out of Calabria, ending up, ironically, in the Papal States. But some of them decided to seek refuge on this mountaintop in Serra Stretta, where Rabbi Barbara Aiello went back and found her ancestor's house that had been the synagogue, had it reconsecrated, and then performed the first Jewish wedding in Calabria in 500 years. Her specialty is very interesting. She claims in her research that a large minority of the population of southern Italy, Calabria, Campania, were actually Jewish. Why? Because she has people coming to her saying, Rabbi, you know, my family is Catholic. We've been going to church for generations, but on Friday afternoons, my grandmother lights candles. Or when someone dies in the family, we cover the mirrors. And Rabbi Aiello tells them, well, your family was probably at one point Jewish. Still these interesting traditions, including the next slide, this tradition of sitting on the small chairs in the process of Shiva, Jewish mourning, okay? My wife and I took her, my son and my godson, to this town. As we passed by this shop, they said, oh, look, how cute those toy chairs. And I said, no, I had to explain. Those are not chairs for dolls. Those are chairs for mourning. Again, you know, omnipresence of death everywhere we go, unfortunately. Another thing, very curious. I'm sure many of you know Gay Talese's memoir, Unto the Sons. And there are two passages that I'd like to call your attention to in this extraordinary memoir. In one, the young Gaetano Gay is in class, and he's listening to a lecture by one of his professors, who tells them that about the Spanish domination of southern Italy, of Calabria. He goes, so cruel were these Spanish authorities that even our own word, spagnarsi, meaning to be afraid, refers to the Spaniards. When we are afraid, we say, io mi spagno. When we say, do not be afraid, it is, non ti spagnare. But if we use these phrases in Rome or Florence or Milan or any other northern Italian city that were never under Spanish rule, we would not be understood. It's really interesting about this whole thing of cultural misunderstandings and La Coperta. I have to tell you this a little risque story. A friend of mine, her father, Mastro Muratore from Calabria, went to the north to do a job. And as he checks into the hotel, the concierge, the person behind the desk, says, well, do you want a coperta for tonight? And it being Bergamo and in the winter, my friend's father said, well, yeah, that would be a good idea. So he checks into his room, and about an hour later, there's a knock at the door. He goes to open the door, and there in front of him is a young lady, scantily dressed. And Giacomo says, well, who are you? And the woman says, well, I'm the coperta. So, talk about cultural misunderstandings. We go from coperta matrimoniale to the other kind of coperta. Next slide, please. As I said to you, my memories of Calabria are filtered through both my mother and my wife. Here is what my wife has written about this house and returning to Calabria. Her grandfather passed away, her father passed away in 2003, and we inherited this house. And she talks about the whole process of having the house restored and the kind of memories that it brought back to her. By the way, she left Calabria not because of any economic reasons. They were relatively well off. They left because my father-in-law was ill and they came seeking a cure for him in America, which never happened. But finally, in the summer of 2007, the house at Via Diaz 25 was ready. By the way, my children are one of the few that know who Armando Diaz was. Yeah, because, yeah. I bet you even people in Italy don't remember who Armando Diaz was. Our children, Alessandro and Giulio, were 10 and 7 at the time. This is 2007. We didn't know quite what to expect when we arrived. Finally, after the longest of journeys, we were standing in front of Via Diaz 25. As my Zia Rosa, who was in her 80s at the time, slowly walked down the street to greet us. We have about four relatives that live on the same street. to greet us with tears in her eyes. We walked into the front door, and we felt like we had finally arrived home. I wasn't entirely surprised by the feeling, as it was something I had waited for my entire life. What I was surprised by was that it was clear that Alessandro and Julia, our children, felt the same way. This place was at once entirely new and yet entirely familiar to them. I knew that the spirits of my grandparents, parents, aunt, uncle, and sister were there with us, because as Thornton Wilder once wrote, quote, "There is a land of the living, and there is a land of the dead, and the bridge is love." Next slide. I'd like to conclude by reading three very short poems that my wife wrote about remembering Calabria. The first one is I Terri, the lands. Your voices whisper to us as we walk on the sacred ground, where the camomilla flowers my mother planted 60 years ago still grow. This was once your Eden, the road that bent just so upon your early morning arrival. The almond tree, still elegant in its sad beauty, the one that beckoned my father to take his afternoon naps in its shade after hot mornings working the land, the wide open Calabrian sky, and the anticipation leading up to sharing those days of wine and laughter during Pasquetta and Ferragosto with the people you loved most in the world. A pristine and now lost Italy, were you conscious of it all? And the whispers come running, rushing back. I terri, com'erano belli I terri, e l'abbiamo abbandonati. The land, how beautiful was the land, and we have abandoned it. The land we bled for, our mythical Ithaca, now it is yours, ghosts walking behind you, stepping on the hardened earth, slightly moistened by your tears. This is the various scenes. We can go, Anthony. We're going to go to Luvara. By the way, if we go back one moment, as beautiful as these olive groves are, the title of my presentation is the title of her last poem, The Melancholy of Olive Trees. This olive grove is right situated next to the Camposanto. Next, this is the house. And this is, okay, Addolorata, the church Addolorata. This is my wife. My father Francesco was the church's priore when he was young and devout. One of my earliest memories is of being with him in that church, the church where I was baptized. On a January morning at his funeral almost 40 years later, I walk with Sir Rosa behind his coffin through the short alleyway, not too far from the house where he was born, our coats fluttering in the cold, cold wind. And the last poem, I can leave it here for 1 second. The Melancholy of Olive Trees. When you first enter the village on the winding road that leads you to the sign that says simply Filandari, your heart skips a beat. And from that distance, you can see the graceful melancholy of the olive trees on that sliver of land that is actually yours, where the trees have lived for hundreds of years, their gnarled trunks and hanging branches reminding you of a long ago fairy tale, trees that watched your parents play when they were children, anxiously awaiting the snakes falling onto their heads while they were being shaken for their bitter fruit. When you see those olive trees, symbols of peace and endurance, you know you are almost home. Thank you.
As scholars and as teachers, to think about devising some systematic roadmap to understanding history, politics, literature. I've discovered writers you mentioned on my own, and Alvaro and a bunch of people. I'm reading, trying to get through Vito Tetti's book on La Senso dei Luoghi right now, on the abandoned villages of Calabria. But it's piece by piece, and I think, you know, to have this place exist only as a function of a family memory or a personal small history is fine, and it's a place to start. But I wonder how you get to the point where you have a body of knowledge available to us here, as well as, I guess, even in Italy, when so much of it's not translated, number one, and it exists in bits and pieces, and it's not so brought together any kind of systematic way that I would love to have a life syllabus for Tutte le cose calabrese, but it's up to you folks to do that. I'm just making a plea to try and get it done.
Make sure you have a microphone, whoever speaks.
Yeah. I mean, was it a question or a comment? It's more
it's on.
Like a...
Yeah.
How do we get to pull, well, we know the things are out there, but social media is a wonderful place to find connections to all the websites and various things that connect you to things. But in terms of what's taught or what's available to just an ordinary person, even what novels are you even understand the literary history of a culture that reflects the richness of the region as it is. Mm-hmm. I don't know even where to begin there.
Well, you know, you are hitting a really, I think, huge, problem. I think there is a system, first of all, I think that there is a disconnect, between, the real history and the mythical version or the nostalgic, experiences. And I don't think, though, it's just about Calabria. I think it really goes about, a lot of the different regions or the different ethnic, I think, the one way to think about that would be for, scholars at the both high school level and academic, college level to integrate as much as possible, pieces of scholarship into what we do, I think that some of us do that in some ways, but it's difficult. I also think that, films or, medias that they can reach a broader audience are also very effective in, trying to bring a more complex, reality and provide more information. But it's a really, I think it's a broad issue. It's a really broad problem. And I think there are many different levels of that problem.
I can add. Yes, it's difficult to suggest one single book that could give you existing book to a whole picture of Calabria today, because of course there are so many different aspects and perspectives, interpretation. Of course, a book is always every book's got its personal interpretation, so you cannot really pitch everything from one source. But for example, that book that now is not anymore here, it was just sold out, the Alessandro Tarzia book. Yeah, that can give you a picture, my point of view, for example. Sort of realistic, provocative at the same mm-hmm. time. And then there are many other sources you can have it, but I can
Is that book translated into English?
No.
I mean, that's I think that's part of the issue too, how to... the publishing industry is very, in crisis in the sense that, people don't like to invest in things that don't sell. So I think that would be another way to do it. Because in Italy, I think that there is a lot more. But the problem is that if you're not fluent in Italian, right. Then it becomes much harder to follow that kind of...
I'm wondering how much of this might be traced to kind of like a lack of institutional support. But having said that, not exactly sure if that's the kind of history that we want, either public or private institutions that would engage in this kind of work. Maybe Margherita, well, Marcella too, they actually work officially in the archives and things like that, they would know this better. But there's something else too. It's like, thinking about Joel's book, this kind of dichotomy that he presents between Florence and Calabria, it's like, we don't want Calabria to be like Florence, it's not necessary. There's no reason to be defensive about it. And I mm-hmm. think he realizes that at the end, when we go back to Calabria and we see beaches like Zambroni, Le Grotticelli, Capo Vaticano, of course, the Germans are there because they know every place, right? But we see our relatives who, can't find jobs. Either they have to leave, or they stay and they live on their grandparents' pension, right? And the other terrible thing is all of these olive groves that, you know, my relatives and my wife's relatives, you know, spilled blood to work, are now abandoned because none of the people my age or younger are going to work those things, right? And we said, well, why don't they do this and why don't they do that? And then I said to my wife, well, they don't want to do it. They don't want to be like Florence, or they don't want, even Puglia is more developed than Calabria as far as, you know, tourists. So I'm wondering if that's really what we want, or do we want Calabria and Basilicata and Puglia to, you know, remain their kind of unique kinds of culture, that not every place has to be Florence. No.
We need some way to make some sense of, if we're going to be proud of anything, we need to know what it is we're proud of.
That's, yeah. And that's, you know, it doesn't begin and end in somebody's kitchen or somebody's backyard or somebody's basement. You know, it's as sweet as that stuff is.
Chronicle and history, yeah.
Yeah. And Calabria, there's a lot, Calabrians, I mean, Rubettino, there's a lot of local publishing, there's a lot of self-awareness that never sort of gets out of there, and unless you have to be there to sort of help figure it out. But just an observation and a plea, if you're thinking of anything as a project, that would be an interesting project for us here.
Yeah, as you were saying that, actually, it reminded me that I was, as I was rediscovering Rossi a Manhattan, you know, Eric, the author, actually has now the book on Facebook, and there was a blog. And one of the things that he was mentioning is that he would love for the book to be translated into English, but that he was having a really hard time to, you know, to do that. So, you know, I hear you. I mean, there is a little bit of a problem.
Other questions?
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you, all three of you. Beautiful presentation. It makes us think about a lot of things. And I just a couple of thoughts more than anything else. The problem is when we look at that interface between personal history and social history, so to speak, or institutional history. I'm glad that Stan used the famous phrase from a title of a book, "The Invention of the Past, The Invention of Tradition," as if invention is supposed to be said tongue in cheek, as if we make it up. But in reality, you cannot not invent as you learn more. Clearly, you know, I spent, as you know, this I heard this morning, I spent 12 years as a child, and then on and off with all the times I went back, maybe another year overall in Calabria going back. But every time I go back, I'm learning more and more about the region. For instance, when I was growing up in the Bronx, I didn't know anything about the fact that there were all kinds of foreign people that had lived in the peninsula. I certainly did not know about the Jews, but I didn't know about the Valdostani. I knew about the Arbesh because we have an expression, the Gegeggio, the people who speak a lot. But that's about it. And then, you know, every time I go back and I look at books, you know, it's like, mamma mia, there's like everybody, like I said this morning, everybody's been through that. Now, the Calabria that you discover as you learn more and more, it challenges your own personal memory at this point, or the family's personal memory. I mean, what you said, like, you yourself acknowledge the stories like that, a lot of people, mutatis mutandis, have been heard before. For instance, who feels the nostalgia? Well, I came up to one little kind of a rule of thumb semiotic. That is, most of the time it was like the man, like my father, who, like, he came here at a late age and couldn't wait till he got back. Not so my mother. she go because she had worked the land, and she goes, wait a second, I have hot water, a refrigerator, and a stove, and you want me to go back? It's like, everything was like, but the thing that really fascinates me is the fact that when you actually go into the archives, when you talk to the historians, when you talk to the sociologists, you really demystify a lot, even of the myth of grandma, the myth of grandfather, you know, that there never was a golden age to begin. It's just something, it's more like a psychological thing about which I'm researching and I'm gonna be writing about, that people construct really after they leave, you know, to sort of hang on to something. So part of going back and say, well, you know, my grandparents traveled here, it's really a personal way of paying homage to the previous generation. But I agree with the last thing you said, Stan, and that is, and a lot of people in the South, and Margherita, Marcella, you can add or correct me if I'm wrong. For many, many years, there was this thing that like l'Italia era sempre indietro rispetto all'Europa. So Calabria was always behind respect to the North. Until Franco Cassano and others started saying, wait a second, maybe they should be imitating us. You know, so they had to put up with this idea that they weren't developing fast enough vis-a-vis the other regions. That for years, when I was studying in Italy, that's all they would say. You know, è arretrata, ci manca questo, ci manca quello. Why aren't they doing what we are doing in the North or in the United States? Well, now that they invented slow food, you know, well, we were slow to begin with on purpose. I mean, it was that's what made everybody live to be 100. Anyway, I think it's kind of an anthropological thing, which is positive, not negative. But let's. But then we can have. We have to pick that up with the various anthropologists, like Alessandro was targeting, studying. What's his name? The one about La Tesi Amorale, the Banfield's thesis. You know.
Well, anyway, that's
a long, complicated thing, but I just wanted to share some reaction. Let me explain. Let me give you another personal anecdote where the personal is a kind of epiphany to the political, right? The first time I traveled to Italy, I was 17 years old. I came from a culture of Southern Italian families and, let's say, a kitchen choreography, let's call it, right? Eating dinner with my relatives in Italy, at the end of the meal, my uncle got up, he took his dish to the kitchen sink. And then afterwards, he swept the floor. This is 1982. And I was like, I was astonished. And it was a moment of epiphany because I realized that my parents had come here in 1950s and 1960s and they had been almost trapped in amber. Whereas Italy was no longer 1962. When we went on that trip, my parents were packing up suitcases as though the war, c'era ancora la guerra, with you know, boxes of Marlboro, coffee, Johnny Walker. We get to Italy, and I said to my parents, they're living better than us here. Why did we? And in gender relations, it was okay for men to go wash a dish or to go sweep the floor. Whereas in America, that never happened. It was a kind of political epiphany. It was astonishing. You know, I was 17 years old. It's like, look at what's going on here. You know, it's a. So there is, you know, this kind of value to the personal, where it then sort of like transcends itself, right? If you can make these kinds of connections.
I just want to share now one personal experience too, which is actually really funny, but it actually really stunned me at the time. When I was 15, I participated to a cultural exchange program between the United States and Calabria. So we were actually, my high school was one of the first few schools to experiment with this idea of, you know, going to live with some American families, and you know, then we would, and I was 14, 15, and of all places, when we went to Ohio, a small town near Cleveland, I mean, and when I went to the family that I was staying with, so she was, you know, the same age as me. And so as soon as I arrived, you know, they literally, like, she had so many questions about, you know, Calabria, but all the questions were about, do you have a refrigerator? Do you have a TV? You know, I mean, there was such a disconnection. I mean, this was 1984, I think. I mean, it's 1984, it's not like 1950, and you know, yes, it was in New York, but in their mind, you know, we were still like very much, and when they came to Soverato, you know, and they spent with us like 3 weeks, they were just blown away. Like, it was just like an amazing, you know, thing. And, you know, going back to like, you know, I think that would be an amazing way to really promote, you know, understanding, like mutual understanding. And also when those experiences happen at that young age, as you say, they can really be transformative because they disrupt the stereotypes more than, you know, any scholar can do, because you kind of witness firsthand, but also you are at an age where you are questioning things with a sort of like fresh eye. So, but I was really, for me, it was just like the idea that we were, as you know, perceived, you know, in the eyes of other teenagers as people that had not, you know, like, yeah, like, but you know, like basic stuff. I mean, when she asked me, "Do you have a refrigerator?" I thought I didn't understand the question. I thought it was my English, and so, but just to give you an example of like some of the, you know, really lost, you know, realities. I mean, it's like it can. There is a wide variety of perception. I don't think anybody thinks that anymore, but you know, it wasn't that long ago.